This is Whitley Strieber, and this is Dreamland. You've reached the edge of the world. Well, today, a wonderful friend is back at last. Joseph Farrell has not been on Dreamland since before the fall. I don't know how long it's been, Joseph. I think it's before COVID, actually. So it's been a long time.
Yeah.
And for various reasons that I can't even put my finger on quite why, but we're back together again. That's the important thing. And being Joseph Farrell, you don't start by saying, well, Joseph, this and this and this. I'm going to just sort of open the door. And what I'm going to do is I think that I had had been looking in Joseph's on Joseph's website, and I had, now I have to look at it. I had sort of, this is called GizaDeathStar.com, and I was exploring mysterious exploding munitions, exotic weapons, and covert war, because there's something else going on in this world. And I related that to things like Havana Syndrome and the Langley drone swarm that happened last December. And if you don't know what that was, folks, the Langley drone swarm was they were described as drones. They shut down Langley Air Force Base. Nothing was said about them beyond the fact that it happened and that the airbase had to be shut down. And the Havana Syndrome, in my book, Them, I pointed out that very briefly on Twitter, there was a post from someone somewhere in the Bigelow world of an MRI of a pilot who had been zapped by a UFO. And the post didn't last long. I've got a copy of it, however, here. It went down almost immediately. And it is what happened to this man was demyelinization of his of nerves in his brain. And he died shortly thereafter. The demyelinization of the nerves looks exactly like Havana Syndrome. So what are we dealing with, Joseph? How about that for a leading?
Well, listen, Whitley, I have thought for a long time that we're watching some sort of covert war, not only between the major powers, you know, the nation-state powers on the planet, but very possibly non-state actors, both terrestrial and otherwise. This whole fascination for me goes way back a few years, about 5 years ago, when there were all these explosions of Russian munitions plants. And then we had ammunition dumps in Iraq exploding. We had the chemical plant in Tianjin, China, that exploded, which to me, of all the explosions that we've watched, that one was hugely suspicious to me. Because the crater that was left from that explosion was kind of a narrow, deep cone. It was not the kind of crater that you would expect to be left from a chemical explosion, no matter how big it was. So I've suspected that there's something going on for a long time. And when you throw in things like Havana Syndrome, which I think is definitely, at least in part, a terrestrial technology. Because one of the things that happened in the Havana case, if you recall, was that some of the Canadian people that were suffering from it reported that they would hear these noises, like metallic scraping against metal. They would hear these noises in their bed, and then they would get up out of their bed and go elsewhere in their apartment, and then the noises would stop. So in other words, it was present in a particular area. And to me, that spoke immediately that, well, this is created by an interferometry pattern over a particular area in their apartment. And if you look up the mind manipulation technologies, this is precisely one of the things they talk about, using microwave interferometry to establish a region of interference. And then that pattern of wave interference sets up a beat frequency in the brain that they can actually modulate information into that beat frequency, just like they modulate information into a radio. So I think we're looking, put all this together. I think we're definitely looking at some sort of exotic technology in use, and that we've been watching a covert war going on for quite a while. I think it's been, to put just a little bit more of a gloss on it, Whitley, I think that since the beginning of the Russian military operation in the Ukraine, and given some of the statements made by the Russian leadership, in particular Mr. Putin, Mr. Lavrov, and especially Dmitry Medvedev, where Medvedev is talking about, you Western leaders are no longer going to have the same types of immunities that you had previously. And we're watching now, I think, the Russians sending messages that they're going to step up this covert war. So, and I do think that they're at least one party involved in it. So, yeah, I think we've been watching this quite a while.
I wonder where these technologies came from, especially the Havana Syndrome technology, because we know that the same thing was used against a pilot, at least one
Yes.
pilot, and I understand that there are quite a few pilots who have been killed.
Yes.
When they go on combat air patrol, arm their missiles and fly aggressively toward these UFOs, it's dangerous.
Right.
And is this, I'm not, we always make assumptions about this alien hypothesis, but I'm not so sure you're completely comfortable with that assumption. And I'd like you to talk about what you think about the possible origins of such technology
Well,
and who's using them,
I'm
besides the
not
Russians, I
against
mean.
the I'm not against the idea of considering that hypothesis as an explanation for these things. My principal problem, at least within ufology, has always been that every human advanced technology has to be explained on the basis of a recovered and back-engineered alien technology. And it got to such a point, Whitley, at least with me, that I began to think, well, pretty soon we're going to have to start crashing our advanced technology on ET's home world so that he can catch back up with us. It became kind of a catch-all explanation. My problem with the mind manipulation technology is you can pursue it back so far, principally back to, World War II and the immediate aftermath. But once you reach that terminus antequam, there's really not much there in terms of the literature that explains who came up with all of this idea and why. So if you're going to look for an alien explanation for things, there are, I think, is a much better prima facie case to be made that you're looking at something genuinely alien in origin with a lot of this mind manipulation technology, because there's no antecedent for it in the literature. And it's just kind of coming out of nowhere. Why would anyone stop and think of microwave interferometry and beat frequencies and modulating information into that as a way to manipulate the mind?
Well,
I
yeah.
really. Yeah, it's a strange thing when you stop and think about it. And the
Well,
other
oh,
problem,
no, go
go
ahead.
ahead. Well,
No.
the other problem I have with the mind manipulation technology is when you start investigating it, it has these almost detailed point by point parallels with people that have experienced contactee experiences, abductee experiences. They talk about telepathy, hearing voices in their head. So I'm thinking, well, you're dealing with a very strange circumstance and with a very strange technology. So why not that kind of origin for it? I think the case is much better there for arguing an alien hypothesis than a Roswell crash and recovery case. But that's just me.
Okay, folks, we're going to take a little break here for just a few moments, and we'll be right back. And when we come back, you're going to get a shock, okay?
Where is the unknown country? Is it out there in the stars? Or is it also somewhere else? Is it in us, in you? Unknown country, join us today. Go to unknowncountry.com right now and join us. Join the questions. Join the search. Join the adventure. Unknowncountry.com. There's no place like it in the world. Have you ever read Communion? Or have you never read Communion? It's out in a new edition. Very powerful, a subtly new cover that reflects the fact that the visitors are now looking back at us because they truly are. You can get it from the unknowncountry.com store as a Kindle, as a beautiful, sumptuous paperback, or as an unabridged audiobook read by me. It's the first time in the whole life of Communion that it has been read in full in audio format, and believe you me, I felt that reading. I put my life, my memories into it, and I trust you can hear it in the voice. I sure felt it while I was reading. So get Communion, listen to it, read it. Communion is of central importance to all of our lives.
We're back with Joseph Farrell. His website, GizaDeathStar.com. It's a very, very cool site, and you can join the community there. It's a fascinating community. I would strongly recommend a visit to GizaDeathStar.com. It's been called that for many, many years. Mm-hmm. And now I'd like to go back to where we were just before the break, if I can.
Sure.
And tell you a story of something that happened here.
Mm-hmm.
One night, some years ago, I was, it must have been 2016, I was overcome with an incredible urge to kill myself.
Oh, wow.
Which came out of nowhere. I was reading or watching television or something. I was perfectly happy. And I thought to myself, this can't be me. Something is wrong here.
Right.
And I literally ended up clutching the chair arms so that I would not go into my bedroom, get my pistol, and blow my brains out. It was the, it was extraordinary. I never had anything like it. Either later that night or the next night, I've never been absolutely sure, the young man who lived below me blew his brains out.
Oh, my word.
So this is real, folks.
Yes,
don't think
it is.
It's not.
Yeah.
And, you know, there's stuff out there. And, you know, there are loads of agendas. And, for example, in this case, I'm not totally without supporters, because otherwise in that level, otherwise I would not be here anymore.
Right.
So how do these agendas, do you think these various agendas work together? I want to concentrate now, if we can, on the alien side of it, because there's more than one someone here and they do not agree.
Right. Yeah.
We talked to that a little bit.
Well, I approach it this way, Whitley. I'm a very traditional Eastern Orthodox Christian. In other words, my thinking is to a large degree formulated by that context. And within that tradition, it's very similar to Roman Catholicism in this respect, because within that tradition, there is a whole theological branch of the church doctrine that deals with angels and demons. And quite literally, when you look at that doctrine, you're dealing with life forms that, number one, are intelligent, highly intelligent. And number two, they are of such a different nature than us. In other words, they're not organic, they're essentially bodiless. You're dealing with something so very different in terms of a life form that it's very difficult for us even to imagine it. And on top of this, there are traditions that these types of beings can actually take on a bodily appearance. They can appear as humans, they can indwell animals, and so on and so forth. So in other words, there's a whole literature here. So when you say that there are many different types of entities here and they're not in agreement and they're fighting it out, I tend to agree with that, because that has been very much part of the Christian tradition from the outset. So I have no difficulty with it. In fact, I just wrote a book called The Demon in the Acre, Angels, Demons, Patristics, and Pyramids is the subtitle to it. But basically, this idea of different kinds of life forms, some good and some evil, and they're all battling it out, and we're kind of caught in the middle. This is not a new idea. I mean,
No, it's not a new idea, but the thing is, though, and that this is what the West has lost track of, I think, that we've dropped the thread in the sense that we basically have decided that the dark side doesn't exist. We're willing to entertain the angels, but we're not willing to entertain the demons. And I think that that has essentially been the result of the Enlightenment, which was a darkening down in many respects. And we now have a situation where something is riding high among us that shouldn't be. And I've been face to face with things that are demons, as another way to put it. I have not been face to face with too many angels, but my wife said, Anne used to say, "Well, who would expect you to be face to face with angels? Of course, you're getting the demons." But that was her attitude. Now, what is this? Let's for in, now let's just cut off the old idea and reform it as different alien species. What would make a species go so dark? I've often wondered that. Do you have any thoughts about that?
Well, even if we attempt to cut off the old, it's difficult to answer that question, but looking at it in terms of what we see going on today. And by the way, I have to agree 150% with you about this being the situation that we're in, being a product of the Enlightenment and the idea of getting rid of the idea that there are bad demonic types of beings or entities out there. Laying all that aside and just looking at objectively what's happening in our culture in this country right now, it almost looks to me, Whitley, as if, number one, there is a full-scale warfare against reality, and therefore it's almost a kind of epistemological warfare. And on top of that, it's a warfare against humanity itself. I mean, everywhere we turn, we're confronted by something that is an affront to normal humanity. And underneath all of those three things, then when you when you stir all those together and boil them down, I think what you're looking at is just plain old-fashioned nihilism. A love of destruction for destruction's sake. And to me, that's pure evil. So again, we can try and escape this, but I think we're being brought back to the idea that there is some sort of evil. And again, you know, your description of what happened to you, and then later that young man that lived in the apartment below you, that is a very palpable thing. I know the kind of sudden oppressive assault that you're describing there, because it's happened to me, not to that extreme degree, but it's happened to me. And I would wager it's probably happened to anybody that's remotely spiritually aware. And my solution to it when it gets that bad is I move. I physically get up and move out of that area.
I've noticed that you do move a lot.
Yeah, you do. You have to.
Does it help?
Sometimes it does and sometimes it doesn't. But I think in the cases where it does help, again, it's like the Havana syndrome. You might be dealing with the technology. And again, it may not be our technology. This may be a kind of modus operandi for entities that like to inhabit or dwell or haunt, if you will, certain places or certain people. So sometimes moving does help. It would be my first reaction, in fact, to that kind of feeling. Just get up and move. You know, the people in Havana that reported their experience had to literally physically get out of the bed that they were in where all of this was happening to them and move. And when they did, it stopped. And I wrote a book, Whitley. I don't know if you're familiar with it. It's called Microcosm and Medium, where I talk about this microwave interferometry mind manipulation technology. And when I say that they can modulate information into those interference pattern waves, I mean they can modulate specific information. They've been experimenting since the 1970s with what I call electroencephalographic dictionaries, where they take words, specific words, and they will match the brainwave patterns of several people in response to those specific words. And they can literally use these dictionaries to read the brainwave patterns and hear or listen into the internal conversation, and then in turn they can take those brainwave patterns, modulate them into that microwave interference pattern, and actually force conversations into people's heads. So this is a very advanced technology, and like I say, you can trace the evolution of this technology back so far in the literature. But then you come up against a dead end, and it just kind of appears out of the blue. And what I think may be happening, at least in my case, I can't speak to yours, but I would wager that it might be very similar. When I've experienced things like that, Whitley, the emotion itself, the mere thought itself is so overwhelming and comes so out of the blue. And it's so palpable. It's like this heavy pressure. And you know it's not coming from inside yourself.
Yes, that's exactly correct.
It's not.
Perfectly happy one second, and the next second I was going to kill myself.
Yeah, bang.
Just like that.
Just like that.
Yeah.
And
that poor boy, I mean, God.
Yeah.
How awful.
Yeah. Yeah. I think it's a technology of some sort, whether whose it is ultimately, I don't know. But, you know, we have to get into our minds that we are in a world now where the spiritual and the technological, particularly in this kind of thing, are not opposites. We're dealing with
merging
a spiritual technology. Pardon me?
This is exactly right. Technology is is penetrating into the world of the soul.
Yes. Yes.
And this is the dark side of this. Is this is what I've seen?
Yeah.
That it is a master of.
Yes. Yeah.
Really.
Yeah. When you combine this kind of technological capability, this kind of technology of the soul and spirit, with the soft techniques of mind manipulation, neuro-linguistic programming, even something as simple as advertising.
Yes.
I think you've got to come to the realization that, yeah, there is a literal spiritual war going on, and these entities, whatever they are not homogenous. They're not all the same. They're not, certainly not morally the same.
No.
I go back to traditional Christian faith, because both within Roman Catholicism, Orthodoxy, and some of the other churches like the Copts and so on, there are these traditions of prayers to your guardian angel. And yes. I lately I've been making a lot of use of those, because I've had these very similar experiences to what you mentioned, Whitley, and they come literally out of the blue.
Right, exactly.
You're never prepared for them. And they most often hit in your dwelling where you live.
Yeah.
Which to me tells me, yeah, this is a technology of some sort you're dealing with. You're dealing with your local spirit, I don't know how else to put it. You're dealing with that sort of phenomenon. So I know wherever you speak, all I can say is, in my experience, it has helped me to physically get up. If I'm experiencing that in my bathroom or in my bedroom or living room, I just get up and move. And sometimes,
interesting, because I'm experiencing it the whole flat. Whole place. And
well, try this experiment. Next time it happens, get up and take a drive or a walk around the block.
That's an interesting idea. What happens, though, it's larger than that in some senses, because I'm working on a new book now, and I had found someone when I was working on them who mm-hmm. was uniquely capable of mm-hmm. doing what Anne used to do with me. Which is not exactly advising or editorial. It was mm-hmm. a much more intimate, not physically intimate, I mean, but much more intellectually intimate thing. And
right.
this individual was really very good at it. And it helped me to write them enormously. Then I came to the new book, which is going to be even more challenging than them. And to my horror, for reasons that make, to my mind, no sense, this individual suddenly refused to work with me anymore.
Oh, wow.
And just like that, out of nowhere. And the reasons given made no sense. And mm-hmm. I just feel, there was an attempt during just before the writing of them to separate the two of us as well.
Mm-hmm.
And it was done like this. First, this flat was broken into, which is nothing new. I mean, it's like a bus station of the weird. and I was very upset, of course, that the place was broken into and nothing was done. And that was the weird part. Just it was made obvious that it had been entered.
Yes.
And so there was nothing I could do. I called the police, but the guy, a cop, a very sweet guy, came over and said, well, we don't have a point of entry and we don't have any evidence. So, just good luck. And I hope it doesn't happen again. That was all he could say.
Uh-huh.
I bought cameras and things then at that point, and one of those electronic doorbells. And then I went down to my son's house and a pleasant morning. And this is an interesting thing is going to happen right here. I'm at a park with one of my grandchildren, and it's Saturday morning, it's quiet, beautiful morning. And suddenly I have this thing in my head, you must look at the website right now. So I open my phone and look at the back end of the website, and there's someone breaking into it in the process
of
breaking into the admin area at that moment. And you see this, we talked about different levels. You know, there's some are on our side and some are against us.
Right.
Whatever was all is on our side, or on my side for sure, got that message into my head on a Saturday morning when I would no more think about going on the website than the man in the moon.
Right.
And, I mean, the back end.
Right.
So I phoned my webmaster, and we chased this guy from IP address to IP address all over the planet. He was really a good hacker. And finally stopped. I then went rushing back to my son's house where I had my laptop. I opened the laptop, called the webmaster, who gave me a new admin username and a new password on the back end without ever going through the front end of the website in any way whatsoever. The second I went in with that, the website, someone else got in, and immediately the website began to be destroyed.
Oh, wow.
And we stopped that too, and with minimal destruction. And we were able to actually redo most of it. And it hit the website in the money, of course. It was it was destroying the bookstore. In any case, I realized that there was something on what the break-in hadn't been about opening drawers or anything. It had been about putting a keylogger on the laptop.
Right. Yeah.
And we found the keylogger and removed it from the laptop.
Yeah.
Then this other person who figures so prominently in this suddenly starts reporting that their emails from years, the past year, are pouring back into their computer out of nowhere. And their email address is showing up on the back end of the website like they were the ones who were doing the hacking.
Oh, wow.
It was designed to separate us. You see how that worked?
Yeah.
And now something has been done, and I can't find out from them because they apparently are too afraid, or whatever was done made them angry or frightened, and they're too afraid to open up to me. They just stopped. And so now I'm left with the new book, struggling. What is this, Joseph? Give me your thoughts about this. Is there black magic involved here, or what? Or is it some kind of mind manipulation?
It's both. I've heard of similar things happening to other people, and it's a pernicious kind of game that they're playing with people. And I think the objective here is to separate people from each other. And in this case, it worked. But the other thing that I think is interesting in your story, I've heard accounts like this, Whitley, from other people on my website. They have told me of similar things that have happened. I have experienced situations myself where I'm noticing things, little things in or around my home that I didn't put there, or that are out, you know, just little stuff like this. It's almost,
you know,
as if
that
you
last happened in this place last night.
Oh, I can believe
last
it.
Last night.
Yeah.
Oh yeah. Go ahead.
Yeah, I can. And it again, I just kind of, you know, it's, in my opinion, it could be some of these entities just having, you know, playing little impish practical jokes, because none of it has been harmful to me. But the thing that intrigues me about your story, Whitley, is that voice that you heard on Saturday, go check your website.
Yes.
And you immediately went and checked. Well, to me, that's very important, because you immediately did that. So in other words, you followed a prompting of your heart and mind that told you that there was some sort of danger that you had to attend to.
Absolutely.
And yeah, and I Whitley, I have experienced very similar things when there has been some sort of prompt that I'm supposed to look into or attend to right away, and it has never let me down. So the other thing I think that is happening in all of this is whatever's going on, we humans are also on the receiving end of some of the good entities influence.
Yes, and thank God, because we wouldn't
yes,
be here
otherwise. Yeah, absolutely, absolutely.
Listen, we've got a second break, which I
okay.
almost forgot because this is such a wonderful conversation. Okay, we're going to take a little break. We'll be right back.
Who are they? Why are they here? What do they want with us? Why is it all so secret? All of these questions are explored in my new book, Them, in an entirely new way. What do Close Encounter reports tell us about what the visitors want with us? What is the military's experience? And can our memories be trusted? Can anything be trusted? Them answers all of these questions in a totally new way. It's available in hardcover, softcover, as a Kindle, and as an audiobook, read by me. Get Them today, and you can get it from the unknowncountry.com store, signed by me. unknowncountry.com. It's huge. It's much more than just a Whitley Strieber book site. It contains thousands of hours of interviews, meditations, podcasts of all kinds. My original hypnosis tapes are there. You can actually hear the moment that I discovered that I, at least, was not alone in this universe, in the office of Dr. Donald Klein so many years ago. Whitley Strieber audiobooks, Communion, Transformation, The Secret School, Breakthrough, Majestic, and so much more, powerful meditations. But more even than all that, it is a community of people who are either looking to gain contact or actually in contact now. There is no community like it in the world. It is absolutely unique. Contact really is happening here. That's what these shows are all about. That's what my life and this website are about. It's real. And it can be of enormous benefit to us individually and to mankind as long as we take our part and do it our way. This is what being a member of Unknown Country is about. So go to unknowncountry.com and subscribe today. Join us, and join, very frankly, the future.
We're talking to Joseph Farrell, his way cool website, GizaDeathStar.com. You can get involved there in a very interesting community. There is a vast amount of material on the website that you can examine, and it's a wonderful place to explore. So GizaDeathStar.com, don't miss it. Now, speaking of missing things, I want to move on now to the present situation with UFO disclosure, David Grosch, Arrow, and all of that, which I can't decide exactly what illusions are involved, which false flags are flying, et cetera, and so forth. But something is way off here. Like, for example, David Grosch talks about bodies. And I happen to know a lot about this. In fact, there's going to be a surprising amount of it in my new book. Because there are bodies. We do have bodies. And we have at least a couple, and maybe more than a couple, maybe a lot of UFOs. So what gives here? Why do they crash, or do they crash, or what's going on? Do you have any, just, I want you to just kind of riff on this if you can.
Well, my suspicion, Whitley, let me go back to what I said about in the previous section about angels and demons. If you look in my book, The Demon in the Acre, I cite a very long passage from Saint John of Damascus. He was a 6th and 7th century Arab saint. He's commemorated as a doctor of the church in the Orthodox Church and in the Roman Catholic Church. So he's a well-known, famous church father. And I cite this really long passage where he's talking about angels and demons. And he makes it clear that these entities are capable of assuming a bodily existence, although that's not their normal, you know, their normal body or their normal form. And I was thinking about that passage in precisely in relationship to the question that you've just asked, because I got to wondering, why wouldn't it be possible to assume that kind of physical appearance or existence and then let it crash? In other words, the angel or the demon doing that shape-shifting, for want of a better word, isn't confined or constricted to that appearance that they create. And they can let it go. And to us, it's going to look perhaps like a dead body or a corpse of some sort. I have to think that we might be dealing, in other words, with that kind of shape-shifting deception, or you used the word illusion when you formulated the question. And I get kind of the same feeling that you do, Whitley, listening to some of these people, Grush in particular. What little I heard of his congressional appearance, I had the feeling that there's just something off here. I don't know exactly what it is.
Something is off.
Yeah, there's something missing. And I get the impression, I don't know about you, I get the impression that they have a suspicion of what that something off might be, but they're not telling us. They're withholding something here that gives me pause. And that was kind of what started me off on this idea of angels and demons, and maybe they're creating these kind of Buddhist tulpas where they're creating a physical manifestation that they're just letting go.
And or a golem.
Or a golem. Yes, exactly. A golem. Very much the same sort of entity.
Yeah.
So I don't know, you know, I don't know what's going on.
Well, you know, the bodies are supposedly at Fort Detrick in Maryland.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And a friend of my family, General Arthur Exon, actually held one in his arms after the Roswell incident, when it was brought to Wright Field from mm-hmm. Roswell. And his attitude was it was like a big insect, which was pretty much what I saw when I was abducted. And
well, you know, there's another thing in the tradition that might speak to this as well. There's that tale in the Argonautica, you know, of Jason and the Argonauts. Toward the end of that, there's this tale of this robot, which, you know, if we were to look at it in modern terms, it would be a golem. Then there's those stories of Albertus Magnus and Thomas Aquinas, you know, his teacher, of Albertus Magnus having constructed a kind of mechanical man. And this comes out of nowhere. So we've had all of these indicators that throughout human literature and lore that there's something that we're dealing with that has a bodily existence that we're contending
with. It has
with.
A physical existence if it wants to.
Right, exactly, exactly. So, you know, I think that if that's the case, you know, let's go back to the end of World War II. And I made this comment at the Secret Space Program conference in Bastrop, Texas, and the one previous to that in San Mateo. That if you're the American post-war deep state and you're confronted with all of this UFO activity and so on, I think it's inevitable that group of people is going to go back and study a lot of this ancient lore for clues as to what they might be dealing with. And when you're dealing with ET bodies or extraterrestrial bodies, I think it's inevitable. They're going to go back and look at every ancient story, every tradition that they can to see if that gives them some sort of clue as to what they're dealing with. Because I think there is something missing to what they're talking about with the stories that they're parading before Congress. And it's this spiritual component of it.
You know, what seems to me to be missing is the whole reality of the distant past, because
yes,
we have the Great Pyramid is on a latitude that is the same as the speed of light.
Yeah.
In other words, and or you take the mala of the Hindus, the 108, that 108 beaded prayer thing, like it's a rosary, right. But it's 108 beads.
Right.
108 is the defining, you can define things like the distance between the earth and the moon, the distance mm-hmm. between earth and sun, the diameter of the earth, the moon, and mm-hmm. the sun, all using the number 108.
Mm-hmm.
Now, how mm-hmm. did they know that in the very distant past? And another thing, yeah. I don't know if you're aware of this, but if you look in Sumerian, carvings, in Mesoamerican carvings, mm-hmm. at Göbekli Tepe, and all kinds of other places in the world, you see these beings carrying a little bag, a little satchel.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Yeah. And, you know, my wife, who was, as time goes on, and I realized that she was so down to earth on some in some levels, and you never would have thought of her as being very weird, but she was, boy, very. She used to say that the most visible thing in the world would be a time machine, and to look for a little box. And is that what those are?
Uh-huh. Well, could be. I don't know, but that's a very interesting idea.
But we're looking, we live on a fractured planet. We live in a fractured world, a broken world.
Yeah.
A fallen world. I mean, if you're into Christian mythology and theology, this is a fallen world.
Yeah, exactly.
And a lot of it doesn't make any sense for that reason.
Yeah, that's right. That's right. So it could be, I don't know. You know, I've wondered myself what those things are. So, it could be. But, the idea that time itself is fractured, I have no problem with. I've been speculating for years, Whitley, about the Mandela effect, which I think is real. I definitely think it's
Tell
real.
Tell us a little bit about the effect.
Well, the Mandela effect is it started with people remembering that Nelson Mandela died in prison in South Africa rather than leaving prison and then eventually becoming the president of South Africa. Others remember different things. I remember the celebrated White House reporter Helen Thomas dying and being eulogized long before she did. I remember Michael Douglas on The Tonight Show talking about the departure of his father, Kirk Douglas, long before Kirk Douglas died. I have a friend out in California, kind of close to where you live, that remembers the death of Richard Chamberlain, Dr. Kildare, before, right. So you've got all these people having different memories that turn out not to be true. And this to me is the essential Mandela effect. I'm not talking about different spellings of Jif peanut butter or Berenstain Bears or any of that. That to me is kind of a distraction. What I'm talking about is people remembering events and specifically other people, famous people that supposedly died and they haven't. Okay. What I think may be going on, I've advanced the hypothesis because the reason I'm willing to entertain the hypothesis is I have a very good memory. And I don't, I'm not prone to misremembering things. And neither is my friend, for that matter. So I began to think, well, what if the Mandela effect is real? What could be going on? And I came to the conclusion that if there is one aspect of modern physics that is a puzzlement to physicists, it's time, and it's the observer effect. We know that the observer effect has a central place in quantum mechanics, but what happens if you try to test for that effect in the macrocosm? So how would you go about doing it? Well, one way that I suggested, as I've been thinking about this problem for a number of years, is that you would plant false stories in a regional media to plant an idea or a memory amongst a group population. And then you would look for effects of that false memory in the macrocosm. Does it have an effect that you can trace in the macrocosm? I suspect that it does. In fact, we may be tinkering with things in such a way that we're creating a kind of, I don't know how else to put it, a kind of porous universe where timelines from one multiverse are overlapping with those of another. And the more that happens, the crazier it gets. And I think there may be a little bit of that going on.
That could be. That's surprisingly, there was a time when that wouldn't have sounded rational. Now it sounds completely sane and probable.
Yeah. Well, I mean, these people are just nutty enough to try something like that. So, I don't assume that it's beyond their capability. The other reason being, when you look at these massive physics projects like CERN, you've got there a case where the world's largest user of the internet, which is CERN, is running this machine that they could easily manipulate the electromagnetic, in my opinion, the electromagnetic cavity of the planet itself through resonance effects. So as they're doing that, somebody there has got to be thinking, well, what sort of aggregate effect might this have on human behavior? Let's track it and see if we can discern any patterns. So I think this has been going on as well as this Mandela effect experiment. So yeah, are they doing all of this? Yeah. Would they use this mind manipulation technology to plant thoughts in our heads that are not coming from ourselves? Yeah, absolutely they would.
Absolutely, of course. I mean, I'm sorry, but I've been done to both of us.
Yes, it has.
So, yeah, so it's real. It does happen.
Yes.
And yeah. You know, you have to wonder what the scale could be. Could they suddenly turn something on that did this to the entire world?
Sure, I think they could.
I think they could too. And you have to wonder, the reason that doesn't happen probably is because of this conflict that's going on.
Yes.
In other words, maybe one side would like to do it and another side doesn't want to. Or maybe they have different agendas, but they both want to do it. And maybe there's more than one side, more than two sides,
yep.
I mean.
So yeah. That could very well be, yeah.
No, easily. So we're going to take another break for our free side of the group. And everybody remember, I will be at Contact in the Desert May the 30th, June the 3rd, go to contactinthedesert.com to find out more. I'm going to be talking about extremely dull things. I'm going to be talking about revisions to the dictionary and various techniques of growing tomatoes. And I'm also going to be talking about what will contact actually be like, personal contact methodologies and close encounter as communication. So don't miss it. Come out there. I want you out there. If you don't come out there, then next year I don't get to go either. So, okay. And Joseph Farrell's website is gizadeathstar.com. And as I've said before, it's full of cool stuff. Go there and get involved. You've got to figure this out, and that's one of the places to start.
You've been listening to Dreamland. Be sure to tune in again next week. Dreamland is brought to you by unknowncountry.com and its family of subscribers. Our theme music is The O of Pleasure by Ray Lynch. Unknown Country was founded by Ann Strieber. Our news editor is Matthew Frizzell. Our coordinator is Amy Safrankova. Whitley Strieber is your Dreamland host. And I'm your announcer, Ted Alexander.